around 12:30 today. The president was taken from Florida to Shreveport, Louisiana, where he made this statement. Let's listen to what Mr. Bush said.
Freedom itself was attacked this morning by a faceless coward. And freedom will be defended. I want to reassure the American people that the full resources of the federal government are working to assist local authorities to save lives and to help the victims of these attacks. Make no mistake, the United States will hunt down and punish those responsible for these cowardly acts. I've been in regular contact with the Vice President, Secretary of Defense, the National Security Team, and my cabinet. We have taken all appropriate security precautions to protect the American people. Our military at home and around the world is on high alert status, and we have taken the necessary security precautions to continue the functions of your government. We have been in touch with the leaders of Congress and with world leaders to assure them that we will do whatever is necessary to protect America and Americans. I ask the American people to join me in saying a thanks for all the folks who have been fighting hard to rescue our fellow citizens, and to join me in saying a prayer for the victims and their families. The resolve of our great nation is being tested, but make no mistake, we will show the world that we will pass this test. God bless.
A grim-faced President Bush in an address to the nation made within the past hour and a half from Shreveport, Louisiana. This after the awful events took place over the span of about an hour and 45 minutes today. An airplane smashed into the World Trade Center tower just before 9 a.m. A second plane followed a little bit after 9 a.m. Eastern Time. A third plane, all of them hijacked, smashing into the wall of the Pentagon about 10 a.m., 9:45, I should say. And a fourth plane crashing in Pittsburgh. It is a day that has forever changed the future of this nation. The response yet to be determined. And welcome to our continuing coverage of the crises in New York and also Washington, D.C. Target America, enemy unknown. Apparently terrorist strikes taking place in the span of an hour and 45 minutes. You're looking at a replay of videotape of the second of two hijacked airplanes smashing into the wall of the World Trade Center in Lower Manhattan. That particular strike came minutes after 9 a.m. Eastern Time this morning. The first tower had already been hit by a similar hijacked plane, flying bombs, if you will. This, then, is video taken from about 10 a.m. After that tower, the second one which was hit, that tower could no longer stand the strain of the flames that weakened the structural elements, and the tower collapsed, sending concrete, glass, steel raining down almost a quarter mile onto the streets below. This now, the second tower, the one that was hit by the first plane, also collapsing, earthbound, in a deafening and terrible and fiery conflagration of smoke, flames, and certainly tremendous loss of life. Perhaps as many as 50,000 people scheduled to work in the World Trade Center towers on this day. It's unknown at this point how many of them were able to make it out. Certainly there were people who did get out from as high as, we have reports, as high as the 92nd floor. But clearly an estimate of perhaps 10,000 people did, and that meant that number may go higher. Now, these pictures from earlier outside the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., or just across the river therefrom, 9:45 a.m. on the south wall of the Pentagon, a hijacked airliner believed to be United Airlines was smashed into the outside south ring of the Pentagon. You can see the smoke billowing up from the headquarters of our nation's armed forces. The building's still on fire. They have not been able to get it out yet. And in fact, we have been told that the flames have penetrated not only the outer ring, but also the inner rings of the Pentagon. Firefighters are trying to get a handle on it, but in a building of that size, they are having a very difficult time. President Bush was spirited away from an event in Sarasota, Florida, put aboard Air Force One, where he made a statement to the nation upon landing at a previously undisclosed location. Shreveport, Louisiana is where the president turned up. He is safe, and so far all officials of the U.S. government, it appears, are safe. But for the first time in this nation's history, all air travel has been grounded, all airports shut down. These are pictures of what's left of the World Trade Center. You can see those leaning shells of what used to be a very familiar sight to many Americans, the steel and glass and concrete towers rising up 110 stories proud. They are simply enormous piles of rubble right now. Again, we do not know how many people have died. There could have been as many as 50,000 people in the building at that time of the morning. Certainly many hundreds of people who were on board those hijacked airliners have died. One of them, American Airlines Flight 11, it was scheduled to fly from Boston to LAX, 92 people on board. Also, American Airlines Flight 77, bound from Washington to Los Angeles Airport, 64 people on board. A couple of United Airlines planes also apparently taken by force by these suicide hijackers, bent on causing the maximum amount of destruction possible, and they have done that, inflicting damage on New York City and on Washington, D.C., that even in the worst terrorist scenarios, nobody could have imagined. I want to bring into the discussion now my co-anchor, Linda Vester, and also Neil Cavuto, who is with us. The stock markets throughout the nation are shut down. The NASDAQ and the New York Stock Exchange never opened today. The world financial markets really in turmoil.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, to jump on that, I think it's important to keep in mind, besides the carnage that you outlined, John, and I know Linda will shortly, this is the financial capital of the United States, folks. This is the financial capital of the world. And that is as important and symbolic as the choice of airlines that these guys decided to hit, United and American. When you can bring to a halt all trading in the wealthiest country on the planet, you have also done a service to your cause, even though a clear calamity to ours. The New York Stock Exchange shut down today. It was supposed to open late. It decided not to open at all. The NASDAQ was shut down today. But here's what's interesting about the World Trade Center. It is actually a complex of buildings way beyond the two gigantic towers that John pointed out that collapsed today. It houses some of the most pedigree firms and financial names on the planet. Morgan Stanley, Dean Witter has essentially been demolished today. Offices that are housed there are now gone from there. They occupied the upper tier floors in the so-called One World Trade Center that was hit by that second plane. We should also point out that the New York Mercantile Exchange was essentially destroyed today. That is where much of the world's oil and energy and metals trading is done. Why is that important? Because if you can stop that or disrupt that, you can cause those prices to dramatically rise. And that is exactly what's happened. Some of the fallout from this goes way beyond the smoke and fire, as you're seeing there on that screen. Oil prices rocketing today, up to $32 a barrel, a better than $6 advance. We're also seeing stock markets across the world falling on this, on concerns that the safe haven of the world is in considerable disarray. Linda.
We want to take you now to Washington, D.C. You now know that the U.S. military has been placed on high alert status. That is U.S. military personnel in the United States and all around the world. There is also, just to give you more information, amid this fire at the Pentagon, apparently from this plane crash earlier this morning, there is a full air cap around all of Washington, D.C. With that, we take it to Tony Snow, who is monitoring things in Washington. He has more new information. Tony?
Thanks, Linda. Well, the Pentagon, Craig Quigley, the Rear Admiral, who's a well-known public affairs officer, has given an off-camera briefing to some of our reporters. He said the Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld was, in fact, in the Pentagon at the time of the explosion, and furthermore, tried to make his way in within the building to the site of the explosion. He went outside for a bit of time to try to assist with some of the wounded, then was ushered back in, and he's now at the National Military Command Center, which obviously is serving as a hub of not only gathering and providing information, but also trying to formulate a follow-up strategy to today's acts of terrorism around the country. And here's Craig Quigley.
The Department of Defense can impose around the world. They are imposed on a local basis because what may be true here in Washington could be very different in San Diego or some other location. Here in Washington, D.C., we are at threat condition Delta. That is the highest condition that we can go to. That is the absolutely appropriate thing to do given the events of this morning. What seems to have happened is that we had an aircraft intentionally fly into the Pentagon. For those of you with cameras, you can see the spot behind me. There were intense fires following the aircraft's impact into the building. Arlington search and rescue personnel are just now, and it's about almost 2 o'clock, just now gaining access to portions of the building where the plane hit because the fires were too intense. The fires are still burning in the Pentagon, at least in that vicinity. We have a variety, too many to even mention, of local first responders, fire departments, police departments, you name it, that have rushed to the aid of the Pentagon here and the people. Each of the military departments is working to set up an 800 toll-free number where family members can call to find out the status of their loved ones. As soon as we have those phone numbers, we will give them to you. I would ask for your help, please, in getting those numbers out as far and wide and quickly as possible so that we can alleviate some of the concern for individuals who have loved ones that work in the Pentagon. I don't have a feel for the extent of damage to the building, but it was significant. And again, fires are still burning, at least in several places in the building. That's about what I know. I'll try to answer some of your questions, but you're going to have a lot more questions than I have.
How about the
the individual right here.
Explain what happened to you personally at the time of the impact. What did you see and hear and feel, if anything? How did you respond? What were you trained to do in that situation?
Well, despite the size of the Pentagon building, many in the building felt a thud and heard kind of a muffled explosion. And it was, at that point, the Defense Protective Service, the fire department, others took off and for action to the impact point in the building. The building was very quickly evacuated. People were sent as far away from the building as possible. Many, many people were sent home. And again, with a request, please call your loved ones right away to let them know you're okay. People were, again, sent as far away from the building as possible. We didn't know what might happen next, and the fire was burning very fiercely at that point in time.
Go ahead.
No, I sensed no panic. People were moving very quickly for the exits to the building, but it was all very controlled.
Do you know what happened?
Yeah.
Rumsfeld
was.
Investigation. Is the FBI handling this, or are there any military agencies?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Investigation. Is the FBI handling this exclusively, or is there any military organizations that are helping with the investigation?
Well, I'm sure the FBI will probably have the lead on this as any domestic sort of circumstance. We will assist wherever.
All right, that is Admiral Craig Quigley. We want to take you now to spokesman for the Washington, D.C. police. Let's listen into what he has to say.
Reports from a variety of federal agencies. Once all that information has been received, the House and Senate leadership will make a determination as how they would like to proceed from this point forward. No, we do not have a plane to approach the Capitol today. I'm sorry?
Are they going in session tonight? Are they going to be in session tomorrow?
That decision will be handled by the House and Senate leadership. We'll have that later on this afternoon. As soon as I have word, the leadership will either issue that statement themselves or they'll issue a statement through me.
Can they be in session anywhere but but the Capitol building? Can they conduct business somewhere else in an off-site location?
I don't anticipate that to happen.
Who just got into the chopper that landed on the Capitol grounds?
That's an area that deals with direct security and national security issues. I'm sorry, I can't disclose that information.